I want to get to the stage John Kuiper and Frans from IBM and tell us how they're getting into production. Here's your slide thing.
Yep.
And I mean, I'm really excited because they were one of the first people who said, hey, we're going to connect everybody from the government and from the OEMs. And why does a company who does logistics in cars, just moving cars from one to the next owner, why can they do that? And why do they take that position? So that was my biggest question. So yep. Take it away and let us know. Thank you. Give him a big hand.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody. Supply chain, finished vehicle supply chain, I'm going to tell you in the next 10 to 15 minutes everything you want to know about it in relation to blockchain. So we are a logistics company, transporting, storing, adding value to cars. Just a normal logistics company, but using, transporting expensive items like cars. And I have to, here we are. So can you see it? Yeah, I tried to visualize for you the finished vehicle supply chain. As you can see, cars are manufactured in plants, and then obviously are transported to the destination to dealers, what you see on the right-hand side. And in that transport process, as you can see from the pictures, cars go on ships, cars finish in a harbor. This is a picture of our harbor location in Amsterdam, where we store 20,000 vehicles. And from there, they are sometimes upgraded, new tires, software improvements, etc., which we do, transported to yet another compound, say from Amsterdam to Munich. And in Munich, they're then distributed to the dealer. And as you can see, sometimes we do it by train, sometimes it goes by truck, but the mission is there's a lot of stages in the process that take handovers of expensive items like cars. And you already saw or see on the sheet a lot of paper, and this paper is what is on every handover is created. And I'll bring one day of Koopman production to you to show you what we're talking about, but I thought I'd leave it to what one truck is carrying when it carries 8 cars. So this is the bunch of paper which is carried by one truck driver when he collects a car and delivers it to the dealers. 4-fold, 8 cars, 32 items, hand-signed, handwritten, and this is only one leg in the chain. Wiebe Dreyer also talked about supply chain and supply chain issues. This is the visible part of the supply chain issue. So I couldn't take one day Koopman production. We have 350 cars. That would be a pile like this, I guess. It would be a little bit too much. But I think you get the message. And of course, these handwritten documents can be wrongly interpreted, can get lost, and need to be kept for many, many years from the law. This is from 2010. We still have them. Just as an example. So this is one of the key issues in the supply chain. And one of the many things that paper is not is real-time information. There are many other issues with paper. Of course, you can't read the handwriting and all that stuff. And although from a consultancy perspective, we hear all the nice stories, you would think the world is far, far ahead, but we still have BMW, Volkswagen, Renault calling us and saying us, do you know where our car is? We have no clue, because the paper-based information trail, of course, is very long. The driver brings it back to the head office. Head office is controlling and checking. Digital systems and legacy systems go back and forth, but the overall view is not there. So what are the key problems? And I'll come to the blockchain solutions obviously later. What are the key problems that our customers face? Because we're doing all this in our own interest to add value to the business, but also to make money and therefore to add value to our customers. Supply chain visibility is a key issue. And with all these steps in the chain, as you can clearly see, you can imagine with all this paperwork, as I mentioned, cars get lost. Where is my car? And there's another significant issue with cars. This is not a Koopman truck, carefully selected picture, as you can imagine. Things like this do happen, but of course you can imagine if you transport, like we do, 1 million cars per year, or when you think about 15 million cars produced in Europe per year, or when you think about 45 million used cars sold per year, and you know things do go wrong. Not like this, but things do go wrong. One of our customers told me that because of this paper trail process, they're unable to allocate 2 million of damage to cars to any driver. The paperwork is not there, the signature is not there, Nobody knows who did it. 2 million euros of cost, just as an example of key issues in this industry. There's another supply chain. That's a used vehicle supply chain. I already mentioned the number, 45 million. Europe, European continent, say the European Union. And of course, for those of you who have experienced, if you have a lease car and after 3 or 4 years you hand it in somewhere, and of course this car is collected, is transported to another compound, can be yours again, and very often is sold from Western Europe, for example, to Eastern Europe. And the key issues that you see on the sheet, there's a significant amount of fraud in this process with very expensive items. Mileage fraud is a very famous one. As an intermediate car dealer, you receive a car, you turn back the mileage from 200,000 kilometers to 100,000, and you say to your customer, look, what a nice car I have, it costs you 1,000 euros more. It is, estimation of the European Union, a fraud issue of around 6 to 10 billion economic value in Europe today. Report of the European Union of November 2017. That's only mileage fraud, not to talk about VAT carousels. I buy a car, I'm telling you I'm crossing it to another country over the border, but I'm selling it around the corner and I'm gone with the money. And then, of course, there's import tax fraud, big in the Netherlands, huge taxes on new cars. You take off a tire, you make a dent, you import the car at a lower value, and you repair the car and you sell it at a higher value. So key billion issue fraud issues in the industry. So what do we do with blockchain to fix these multi-billion problems? Basically, and all of you are familiar with blockchain, and those who weren't this morning have followed the course for dummies. So the principle of following the VIN, the vehicle identification number, like with diamonds, is obvious. So that's what we want to do, and that's also what we sell to our customers. If we follow the VIN through the life cycle of the vehicle, from new to dealer, from used car to the next user or buyer, if we follow the VIN and keep the records, the information in the blockchain, then obviously the buyer in, say, Bulgaria, who buys a Western European car, or the other way around, can, for example, always check what the latest mileage of the car was when it was sold by the original vendor. So we're there. We are operational today as we speak with one of our customers in a trial where we deliver cars in a purely digital process, blockchain-based. So you can see we keep all the logistics records. Where is the car? Has it left already? What is the estimated time of arrival? In what status has it been delivered? But also all the technical records. What was the mileage? Was there a dent? Was there damage? Creating this visibility for our customers, that's what they want. Where is my car, as I explained? But also creating legal documents in the blockchain. And with these legal documents, for example, if you have an electronic delivery document in the blockchain, it's a legal document. You can automate your payment processes. So you can say to, I can't use the word smart contracts anymore, I understood this morning, but in a miraculous way, you can tell the bank to pay after 60 days the payment terms that you agreed with your customer, the fee for delivering the car on that location. So you wipe out all the processes of collecting and sending invoices, payments going back and forth, and all the issues related to that, which is a huge cost in the industry. Just one example of what you can do. And clearly, it's a nice picture, but these things do happen. I mentioned about import tax fraud. People are taking away cars to import the parts separately and then to build back the car. So this is a bit in the extreme. But it tells the story. Obviously, when we record the mileage, I talked about that already. We track the destination of the vehicle delivery. Is it indeed delivered in this country, on this location, with this ID, the person who really bought it, VAT fraud. So we create one single truth per vehicle that enables the things that you can read on the sheet. So where are we today? We moved fast. We had a vision, we believed in it, we worked together with IBM, and we successfully came from POC to production. So we're in production now with one customer. We'll do a trial with a car manufacturer, OEM, in a few weeks from now, giving them mass visibility of their supply chain. But definitely we do know and we do believe we can't do this on our own. So I'm actively now engaging other companies like Koopman in Europe to see whether we can create a consortium and also other interested parties to help us to set a standard in this automotive supply chain. So that's in short my story, and then I'll happily hand over to Frans, who will tell you from an IBM perspective how we work together.
Okay, thank you very much, Jon. And as IBM, we are really very happy to work with such an innovative company like Kai Koman. Like, I must confess as well, last year, 1.5 years ago, when we started working together, I didn't know Koman yet. And I suppose now, after today, you all see Koman trucks on the street, like I do as well. And it's interesting to see that, let's say, a company, a relatively small company like Koman, in the entire automotive ecosystem, is working itself way up through not only providing transport, but moving to a new business model of transporting new services, of supplying new services. And not only physical services, but also IT services. And that's where this roadmap is going towards in providing blockchain-based services. So in a summary, with blockchain with automotive, we can reduce the cost of supply chains using, let's say, the visibility transparency of blockchains. You can also create trust in the entire supply chain of buying and selling cars, in original parts, in accidents, in preventing mileage fraud. But also, and that will be a next step, you can use the power of smart contracts. And smart contracts is nothing more than, let's say, logic in your application which executes, let's say, business processes automatically, and you can use tokens in it. So the third step is to provide services on top of your blockchain platform. Service in terms of the cars will be intelligent in the future. There will be IoT devices in your cars. You can pay things with your cars. You can do much easier car sharing, flexible insurance, flexible mileage. The rental companies, the lease companies can have much more flexibility in their service towards their clients when they have a blockchain platform using tokens in the platform. And we are now also experimenting with, let's say, a car e-wallet in Germany, and we will mix that with our VIN-based ledger in the future. My talk's about a bit about the technology, and I suppose this will be the first and maybe the last time you will see a bit about technology, but what's under the hood? We're in the automotive industry now, right? So we have a sneak preview what's under the hood. What does it take to build these IT platforms? Let's run in through the life cycle of how you start with a blockchain project and how you get it into production. And there will be much more details in the technical work stream in this afternoon, where we will explain how we really physically build the blockchain platform. But it's a high-level overview. So we start with an enterprise, a company who has a vision to start experimenting with new technology. Then you do design thinking workshop. You go with the IBM team, architects, developers, business consultants, but also with the client, with the business and IT together in discussing their business process and selecting in that business process which is the best process to start trying out if blockchain technology is a good solution for this. So you take this business process, small, maybe you invite some consortium partners, one or two, not more, otherwise the decision cycle will be too long, just a small scale consortium, and start designing your solution. What do you want to build? What is functional? What is your technical roadmap? And then moving fast forward, you develop the code in Agile Scrum with your team, with the product owner of the client side, together with the IBM development team. You set up the infrastructure on-premise or in the cloud, whatever the client wants, and then you start building the MVP. The MVP basically fit for trialing, which is the stage we are now in at Koman. And then you start trialing and testing, et cetera, the entire environment, and then you prepare for production, which is not easy. I mean, it's really an IT project. And then you run and maintain. And run and maintain, you provide services to external companies, and it's a production system, right? So you're dependent on the functionality and the going live and the service levels you provide towards the market. So it must be a robust system which provides the right level of services. And going then a little bit more into the hood, but that's really a short sneak preview. What's behind this? A user will log into the system with a desktop or a mobile. In the future, there can also be IoTs, devices, which will log into the system, and it goes into the server environment, the app server, basically. And then it goes also to the enterprise environment, because integration with your enterprise systems is also key. It gets the information, it authenticates the users, it creates a blockchain ID, and then it moves into the blockchain platform, basically. And blockchain platforms are basically some peers, some nodes, who work together in a consensus protocol. And on top of that, there's a smart contract, who does the business logic and the intelligence on top of it. Of course, there's certificate authorities, who can authenticate the users. And it's all based on the Hyperledger fabric platform we are using. And Hyperledger is a permissioned blockchain, or a private blockchain, in other words, but not an open blockchain platform. Because we believe as IBM in, let's say, a blockchain for business, where if you do business in a consortium, you want to know who are you doing business with. You want to know who the legal entity is. And not anybody can join your network, right? It's a matter of trust. If you have a permission network, then your consensus protocol needs to be as tight as an open network, so your speed of transactions can be much higher. So that's why we support the Hyperledger Open Source Foundation, and we donate code to that. So that's the blockchain platform. And then, of course, you have all kind of monitoring services, security services on top of it. But this is, let's say, getting the hands dirty. Yeah? We have a sneak preview under the hood on, let's say, the process. Now we get into the engine, basically, gets our hand dirty. But in the end, if you look at the high level, and we talk about implementing a blockchain platform, creating smart contracts, that's the nice part, right, of implementing IT service in a network. The nice part is developing a smart contract and, let's say, defining the consensus protocol. That's only the 10% of the work. The hard work is the regular IT project stuff, right, to make it happen, to build it, to let it run, to make it ready for business enterprise-ready production systems. So these are all elements which you need to take account of. Also, of course, GDPR. How do you treat the element that you have the right to be forgotten? Should you use it in the blockchain or outside the blockchain? Or security, identity, client support. How do you do this? DevOps system. So these are all typical IT issues which you need to solve, which is really the hardcore engine of the auto, which you need to have experience with. And I'm happy that we can leverage, let's say, the 400 plus projects IBM is working now worldwide on blockchain, in implementing blockchain technologies. So we have a huge knowledge network to get the information and the knowledge inside in the Netherlands using for our clients. So with that, that was a sneak preview in the automotive industry and how you build blockchain technology. Thank you very much.
Okay. Well, let's see, there were a lot of questions. Last time was also the question, you need humans in the chain, right? I mean, for example, I have here the question, how do we ensure that the card isn't tampered with in the process? I mean, you know, you need information, and people need to put information in that chain. And so how do you make sure that it's not crap in, crap out?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, of course, it's rubbish in, rubbish out.
Yeah.
But in that process, specifically of used cars, you have historically many people, middlemen, that are disappearing in this process.
Yeah, we call them oracles in this world.
Ah, okay,
oracles.
Okay.
Oracles, they put in information from the outside world in there. Yeah,
yeah, so these middlemen were historically, traditionally, the people who were cheating, basically. And the companies that are now, with the disappearance of the middlemen, selling cars, used cars, think about the Leaseplan, the ALZs, the real big companies, they are on their banks, more or less. They live from credibility and security. So, of course, Leaseplan provides always an official report of the mileage of the car. And, of course, rubbish in is rubbish out, but that's where it starts. And then in the process, up to most of the times Eastern Europe, obviously also the other way around, people can check the original Leaseplan mileage.
And RDW, do they also participate?
Yes, we talk actively with the RDW, so that's the Dutch authorities that audits the import and export process. They're extremely interested. They know all the processes, they know where it's going wrong.
But they're not involved yet. We don't have access to their mileage, because they also have mileage.
Yeah, right?
They would be a great trusted oracle, because they're a government, they're from the government, they're trusted.
Yeah, no, the Netherlands is not perfect yet, and this is a way to make it perfect.
Okay.
But we actively talk to them, and they're very interested.
Okay. Question, are you going to set up an ICO for funding, or will you fund it privately?
Not sure yet.
Okay. But maybe you're thinking about it.
All options are open.
Okay. And why is blockchain better than a well-developed distribution full-stack system?
Because if you have a distributed database, then you still have a middleman. You have one party who controls the data. But what if you can distribute the data all over other parties, and all parties can add value to the data or change the data? And that's also the first question about, it's a human business, right? So you can make mistakes in entering data. But that's about the agreement you make in your consortium of 10 companies. How do you agree which information is put into blockchain? So is it 2 out of 10 or 3 out of 10? So there are also more eyes involved in putting the information in the blockchain. And that's also the basic of the security.
Okay, so that's the old question always, like the distributed databases. Okay, wonderful. When are you going to live? When is going live?
We're working yet now in a trial with Pond Logistics, our customer in the Netherlands.
Do I get a nice little app so I can basically test, put them in my VIN number and see all the information you know about it?
As a consumer?
Next year?
Next year at this conference?
Okay, so we're going back today. Last year, Tennet came here about a case, and we're going to have Leo, he's flying in from Scotland to see what happened a year ago, because he said, we're going to do this and blah, 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 and it was the first case where which are going into production. They are in production, and they're going to tell us, and next year you're going to come back to see where you are, and if you do an ICO, because that is really, but now the next version is all the traditional companies are doing an ICO, because they're so trusted. Thank you very much for coming. Yeah. Okay.